The Hound of the Baskervilles by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
The light shines still. How far do you think it is?
Well, out by the cleft Tor, I think. Not more than a mile or two off.
Well, it cannot be far if Barrymore had to carry out the food to it. And he is waiting, this villain, beside that candle. By thunder, Watson, I am going out to take that man.
I got my revolver, and in 5 minutes we were outside the door, starting upon our expedition, the night air heavy with the thick autumn smell of damp and decay. The light still burned steadily in front.
We must close in on him rapidly, Sir Henry, for he is said to be a desperate fellow.
I say, Watson, what would Holmes say to this? How about that hour of darkness in which the power of evil is exalted? What was that, Watson?
I don't know. It's a sound they have on the moor. I heard it once before.
Watson, it was the cry of a hound. What do they call this sound?
Who?
The folk on the countryside.
Oh, they are ignorant people, Sir Henry. Why should you mind what they call it?
Tell me, Watson, what do they say of it?
They say it is the cry of the Hound of the Baskervilles.
Yes, the hound it was. I'm not a child. You need not fear to speak the truth. Can there be some truth in all these stories? Is it possible that I'm really in danger from so dark a cause? You don't believe it, do you, Watson?
No, no.
And yet, it was one thing to laugh about it in London. It is another to stand out here in the darkness of the moor and to hear such a cry as that.
Shall we turn back?
No. By thunder, we have come out to get our man, and we will do it. We after the convict, and a hellhound, as likely as not, after us. Come on. We'll see it through. If all the fiends of the pit were loose upon the moor.
We stumbled slowly along in the darkness, with the black loom of the craggy hills around us and the yellow speck of light burning steadily in front. At last we could see whence it came, and then we knew that we were indeed very close.
What shall we do now?
Let us see if we can get a glimpse of him.
There he is!
An evil yellow face loomed out of the rock. A terrible animal face, all seamed and scored with vile passions, foul with mire, with a bristling beard and hung with matted hair, and small cunning eyes which peered fiercely to right and left through the darkness. He sprang to his feet and turned to run. A lucky long shot of my revolver might have crippled him, but I had brought it only to defend myself if attacked and not to shoot an unarmed man who was running away. We chased him for a long time in the moonlight, but the space between us grew ever wider. Finally, we stopped and sat panting on two rocks while we watched him disappearing in the distance. And it was at this moment that there occurred a most strange and unexpected thing. The moon was low upon the right, and the jagged pinnacle of a granite tor stood up against the lower curve of its silver disk. There, outlined as black as an ebony statue on that shining background, I saw the figure of a man upon the tor. He stood with his legs a little separated, his arms folded, his head bowed, as if he were brooding over that enormous wilderness of peat and granite which lay before him. He might have been the very spirit of that terrible place. I pointed him out to the baronet, but in the instant during which I had turned to grasp his arm, the man was gone. He is no one whom I have seen down here, and I have now met all the neighbors. The figure was far taller than that of Stapleton, far thinner than that of Franklin. A stranger, then, is still dogging us, just as a stranger dogged us in London. We have never shaken him off. In the meantime, Barrymore took Sir Henry to task for pursuing his wife's brother, the convict Selden, who, he assured us, would within days be on a boat to South America, and then showed us his gratitude in a practical manner when we agreed not to inform the authorities.
I know something, Sir Henry, and perhaps I should have said it before, but it was long after the inquest that I found it out. I've never breathed a word about it yet to mortal man. It's about poor Sir Charles' death.
Do you know how he died?
No, sir. But I know why he was at the gate at that hour. It was to meet a woman.
And the woman's name?
I can't give you the name, sir, but I can give you the initials. Her initials were L.L.
How do you know this, Barrymore?
Well, sir, only a few weeks ago, my wife was cleaning out Sir Charles' study. It had never been touched since his death, and she found the ashes of a burned letter in the back of the grate. The greater part of it was charred to pieces, but one little slip, the end of a page, hung together, and the writing could still be read. It said, "Please, please, as you are a gentleman, burn this letter and be at the gate by 10 o'clock. Beneath it were signed the initials L.L.
And you have no idea who L.L. is?
No, sir. No more than you have. I didn't like to say anything about it before because it's well to go carefully when there's a lady in the case.
Well, Watson, what do you think of this new light?
It seems to leave the darkness rather blacker than before. But we must let Holmes know all about it at once. Maybe it will bring him down here at last.
The day following, I searched for the solitary watcher on the Black Tor, but without success. As I walked back, I was overtaken by Dr. Mortimer, who insisted on giving me a lift.
By the way, Mortimer, I suppose there are a few people living within driving distance of this whom you do not know.
Hardly any, I should think.
Well, can you, then, tell me the name of any woman whose initials are L.L.?
Laura Lyons. Her initials are L.L., but she lives in Coombe Tracy. As a matter of fact, she's Franklin's daughter.
What? Old Franklin the Crank?
Exactly. And she married an artist named Lyons who came sketching on the moor. He proved to be a blackguard and deserted her. Her father refused to have anything to do with her because she had married without his consent. So, between the old sinner and the young one, the girl has had a pretty bad time.
He wanted to know the object of my inquiries, but I managed to satisfy his curiosity without telling him too much. Tomorrow morning I shall find my way to Coombe Tracy and see this Mrs. Laura Lyons of equivocal reputation. I have not lived for years with Sherlock Holmes for nothing.
Well, Barrymore, has this precious relation of yours departed, or is he still lurking out yonder?
No, I've not seen him since I left out food for him last. But the food was gone the next I went that way.
Then he was certainly there.
So you would think, sir. Unless it was the other man who took it.
You know that there is another man, then? Have you seen him? Well, how do you know of him?
Selden told me of him, sir, a week ago or more. He's in hiding, too. But he's not a convict, as far as I can make out. I don't like it, Dr. Watson. I tell you straight, sir, that I don't like it.
But about this stranger, what did Selden say? Did he find out where he hid or what he was doing?
A kind of gentleman he was, as far as he could see. But what he was doing, he could not make out. He lives among the old stone huts on the hillside. Selden said he has got a lad who works for him and brings him food and such.
It is a wild night indoors, and what must it be in a stone hut upon the moor? What passion of hatred can it be which leads a man to lurk in such a place at such a time? I swear that another day shall not have passed before I have done all that man can do to reach the heart of the mystery.
When I reached Coombe Tracy, I told Perkins to put up the horses, and I made inquiries for Laura Lyons. I had no difficulty in finding her rooms, which were central and well-appointed. She eventually, and reluctantly, conceded that Sir Charles Baskerville, through the agency of Mr. Stapleton, had helped her, but hotly denied she had ever written to him requesting a meeting.
Really, sir, this is a very extraordinary question, to which my unequivocal answer is certainly not.
Not on the very day of Sir Charles's death?
No.
Well, surely your memory deceives you. I could even quote a passage of your letter. It ran, "Please, please, as you are a gentleman, burn this letter and be at the gate by 10 o'clock.
Is there no such thing as a gentleman?
You do Sir Charles an injustice. He did burn the letter. But sometimes a letter may be legible even when burned. You acknowledge now that you wrote it?
Yes, I did write it. Why should I deny it? I have no reason to be ashamed of it. I wished him to help me, but I never kept the appointment.
Mrs. Lyons.
No. I swear it to you on all I hold sacred. I never went. Something intervened to prevent my going.
And what was that?
The matter is a very private one.
The more reason why you should avoid a public investigation.
I will tell you then. If you have heard anything of my unhappy history, you will know that I made a rash marriage and had reason to regret it. My life has been one incessant persecution from a husband whom I abhor. At the time that I wrote this letter to Sir Charles, I had learnt that there was a prospect of my regaining my freedom if certain expenses could be met. I knew Sir Charles's generosity, and I thought that if he heard the story from my own lips, he would help me.
Then how is it that you did not go?
Because I received help in the interval from another source.
And why then did you not write to Sir Charles and explain this?
So I should have done, had I not seen his death in the paper next morning.
Why should she turn so pale? Why should she fight against every admission until it was forced from her? Surely the explanation of all this could not be as innocent as she would have me believe. For the moment, I could proceed no farther in that direction, but must turn back to the stranger who lived among the stone huts upon the moor, the man on the Black Tor himself. It will indeed be a triumph for me if I could run him to earth when my master had failed. Luck had been against us again and again in this inquiry, but now at last it came to my aid, and the messenger of good fortune was none other than Mr. Franklin.
The Hound of the Baskervilles by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.